You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
For the community, by the community.
For the community, by the community.
For the community, by the community.
Get ready to find hope. Get ready to be inspired. Get ready to discover your full potential. Get ready for total success. From the Total Success Coach, Princess Bola Adelani.
Hi, this is Princess Bola Adelani, the Total Success Coach, welcoming you to Inspired Success, your monthly dose of inspiration power, the program that equips you with the power and inspiration for total success. That is success at work and in life. Thank you so much for tuning in. Honestly, you would be pleased, you'll be excited to know what I have in store for you today. So don't you touch that dial now. Call that friend of yours, get them on the phone, tell them that Inspired Success is on air. Put on your DVD because you really want to record this show, I'm telling you, okay? And just position yourself, relax, and get ready to be inspired and to be challenged and to be informed. And guess what we're talking about today? Relationships. Yes, that's what I said. We're talking relationships on Inspired Success. Tips, tools, and strategies for great relationships. I need to really give you a background because this broadcast today is actually a sequel to my June broadcast. You remember the one on one thing that men want women to know about men. Okay, I'll take that again. It was titled One Thing That Men Want Women to Know About Men. And honestly, I cannot believe it even up till now that this show has been so well received. To date, thousands have watched it via television and several hundreds have watched it online on the internet. And so, you know, it told me that there was a need for a sequel. There was a need for this conversation to continue between men and women this time around. So today's show is really about men and women talking about relationships and about what really is at the bottom of our misunderstandings. I was saying in my last show, and don't forget that you can go online to whctv.org to view the show's video on demand at any time. But I was saying at my last show that the statistics when it comes to divorce are staggering. 60%, it is what it's at today in America. That means 6 out of 10 marriages end in divorce. And the funniest thing is that 90%, 80 to 90% of single people want to be married, okay? That's why eHarmony, you know, Match.com and all these relationship websites, dating websites are a billion-dollar industry. So, you know, we can't seem to stay together. And at the same time, we don't want to stay apart either. So what is this? What's going on here? Why can't men and women get along? Why are we, you know, divorcing? And why do we want to also be together? What is at the bottom of our misunderstandings? Are we so different from one another? You know, people have said things like women are from Mars and from Venus, I beg your pardon, and men are from Mars. You know, are we so different? Are we aliens? Do we speak totally different languages? And so this is all going to be part of our discussion today. And I'm not by myself, and I'm so excited because I have a very diverse panel of everyday people, really. Everyday men and women, diverse backgrounds, diverse generationally, and, you know, who are just going to be kicking off this conversation with with me today. Like I said, one of the audience studio, my guest is actually a relationship expert. Yes, we have a guru in the house. And he's a published author, and he'll be introducing himself, and we'll be meeting him later. I really believe that at the end of this show today, you'll be better positioned, better equipped for successful relationships. So please help me to welcome to Inspired Success, Kelsey Behrens, and please help me now because I'm going blank. I'm drawing a blank here. Diane Drakes. And Mark Sack, who is no guest here again, he's coming for the second time. And there's Marisol Alvarez, there's Jess Punsalen, and this is our guru. And each one of them is going to get a chance to introduce herself, T.C. Brantley. And really, I want to welcome you to Inspired Success. Thank you so much for being here.
Yeah.
Why don't we start with you, Kelsey, by just sharing a little bit about yourself, who you are. You know, they might not have caught your name. You can give them your name again, what you do, and you know, a little bit of a background, and then we're going to kind of go round the room.
I am a junior at the University of Hartford, and I'm your intern. I love it. It's a bunch of fun. I am 20 years old, and I'm currently in a relationship. So as we've talked earlier with you, I really did find this broadcast to be very interesting, and I'm really, really excited to talk about it. So
thank you so much for being here again, Kelsey. Diane?
Hi, I'm Diane Drakes, and I am the Director of Diversity at St. Joseph College. I'm working on a project with you, and that's how we got an opportunity to meet, so looking forward to that, our conference in November. And I've been with the college for about 3 years, and it's really nice to be here to be able to talk about relationships. At a women's college, we have lots of opportunities to talk about relationships and lack of relationships, all of that good stuff. So definitely really great to be here. And I'm currently in a relationship myself. So
That's awesome. And I just wanted to even say that at this point that I am partnering with St. Joseph's College, and I'm presenting a program to really equip young girls and young women on Saturday, November 6, 2010. You know, so now Inspired Success and Royal Proclamations is touching all peoples and all spheres of life and all generations, really. So it's really kind of very exciting for me. I want to use this opportunity to invite viewers to the first annual Total Woman Conference for girls and young women on Saturday, November 6, 2010. So if you're a mother or you're a student yourself or a young girl, you want to really, really, really be a part of this program. And more information is available on my website at royalproclamations.com. So, but anyway, let's go to Mark and share a little bit with the viewers about who you are and what you do.
Thank you, Princess Paula. We've known each other for years now, so yes. You know, I appreciate you having me on the show again.
Again, time. Yes.
So it's always fun to communicate with you because I think the world of you.
Thank you.
My name is Mark Sack. I'm a financial planner and a wealth advisor right here in West Hartford Center with a company called North Star Wealth Partners, where I help businesses and we help families. You know, they come to me look at me as their financial quarterback for all the financial issues that happen in their life. I'm 40 years old. I am currently single. And I'm one of those guys where everyone goes, where all the girls go, how are you single? If I wasn't married, you know, that's typically what I get.
Okay. You know. So I'm sure this broadcast will help you a great deal because we're going to be touching on that really and truly about how, you know, single men and women can attract the right mate, right person into their lives. You know, we're going to be touching on that because once we've been able to figure out what is at the root, at the bottom of our misunderstandings, then the next step is, you know, what wisdom have we learned or do we gain, and how do we put those wisdom into practice, you know, and to help us to really make the right choices and stay and have great relationships. So yeah, absolutely. This is good for you. So all those single men and women out there, you want to be writing. You want to take notes today because I'm telling you, you know, full of information, inspiration, and the result is transformation. Yes, Marisol.
Thank you, Princess, for having me here today. My name is Marisol Alvarez. I work for AmeriChoice by United Healthcare. I am a community outreach coordinator. I do a lot for the community. I'm also involved in a lot of community events in New Britain and Hartford. I'm currently in a new relationship, but I am divorced. I'm 34 years old, and I'm here to talk about my experience about relationships and see if I identify with other people on the panel.
Exactly. And you see, so there are single people who are single as a result of being divorced, you know. And so we don't want to make the same mistakes the second time around. We want to learn from our previous relationships and learn what went wrong and all of that. So it doesn't matter what your relationship status. Don't think, oh, this is for singles only or for married only. You know, whatever your relationship status, I can promise you that you really, really benefit from this broadcast today. Lastly, but definitely not the least, I want to bring in, before we talk, he is an indifferent. So in terms of expertise here, but Jess, why don't you introduce yourself to our viewers?
I am a photographer. I specialize in weddings and maternity photography and newborns. I am newly married. It is my second marriage. I just got married in July. And I was a single mom for most of my son's 14 years up until my new marriage. So that definitely presents some challenges. So
So you see, that's what I'm talking about, the diversity we have in the studio. Single mother, recently remarried. So we're coming into all kinds of issues here when relationships come out in terms of sometimes the challenges in relationships, which is a lot more families in America today are blended families.
Correct.
And what does that pose? What challenges do they pose in terms of, you know, staying together and building successful relationships, marriage relationships? You know, so, I mean, everyone is in the room, really. Everyday men and women, professional men and women that I'm sure that you can relate to, you know. So, like I said, please do not touch that dial. And do you know why this is a special, this is a classic? It's not the usual 30 minutes. It's 60 minutes, really, of tips, tools, and strategies for great relationships. 60 minutes of tips, tools and strategies. So you make sure, you know, you're really kind of comfortable and getting ready to be truly inspired and informed and really kind of transformed. Thank you. And now, T.C. Brantley, wow. It is a great honor to have you here today. This man is just a phenomenal man that I truly, truly respect, particularly with all due respect, because he's a man of color, and oftentimes men of color have been stereotyped into certain roles and models that are not quite true. So it's always refreshing to meet one that does not feel the stereotype, that is doing great professionally, doing great personally, very academically, very smart man. And so I'm really, really honored and truly pleased that you're here. So really, we're going to really dive into the conversation.
Let's dive.
Yes, we're going to dive into this conversation here. And this is the question. Why can't we stay together? Why can't we stay together? Why is the divorce rate so high, especially in the States? It's alarming. You know, it's becoming an epidemic. At 60%, 6 out of 10 marriages ending in divorce, as far as I'm concerned, not good. Mm-hmm. Not good economically, not good emotionally. It's just not good for the society, okay? So why? That is the question. Why can't we seem to stay together? What is at the bottom of some of the misunderstandings? Mm-hmm. Are we so different? And I don't know who wants to kick off the conversation.
Well, the main reason why that couples are not staying together is that, number one, they are so full of endorphins and oxytocins when they first get together, the loving, the kissing, oh, can't wait to be out with you. And then when they get married, those hormones start to go downhill. And so what I teach couples to do is that you got to learn to appreciate your relationship and not depreciate. Depreciation is very common, as you know, in the financial business, that if you don't do anything to the house will automatically depreciate.
Yeah.
So a lot of couples, what they do is that they get married, they get together, but there's no working on the communication, there's no working in the bedroom. And so after a while, the depreciation, there's no value left, here comes divorce.
Okay, so now you've touched on one or two things that I've heard. And what I've heard is, number one, people do not really truly understand the work.
Yes.
The work, that's
yes.
it.
That's right.
And are not prepared for the work that goes to building a successful marriage. That's number one.
Correct.
Number two that I heard from you is that marriage has been romanticized.
Yes.
You know, it's all about, in the initial states, it's all about the, you know, very transient.
Right.
Transient
exactly.
part of the relationship, which
right.
is about the, you know, like you said, the mm-hmm. romantic part. Mm-hmm. Oh, you know, I like being with you. It's more of an illusion.
It is
of
an illusion.
What we imagine at that point.
And then you wake up.
And then the reality sets in. Exactly.
Hear that, and,
yes.
and TC, I'm like so on your page, so
yes.
thank you for being here, and
no
I'll hire you later.
All right, go ahead.
But the bottom line is, at least from the experience when I talk to couples in my business or things or people getting divorced, and I understand, it's what my mom would always refer to as the googly eyes. You get these googly eyes.
And
so, and what I've always come to now garner and understand in my own life, that's mm-hmm. not the relationship.
No.
Yes.
So where we say, okay, that's transient part of the relationship, I actually beg to differ and say that's not the relationship.
Okay.
What that is attraction. It's lust.
Right.
It's, they're funny, they're comedy, they make me feel good, that sort of thing. But that is not longevity.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And what I find that when you talk to the most successful people and you say, well, gosh, you talk to your grandparents who've been, you know, married 70 years, 60 years, and you find these people and you say, what is it? And what how did you stay together? Like, mm-hmm. what was the magic? Like, what was it? And they come back with the same thing. And the thing is that they have the same life goal. You know, and I think that a lot of people get divorced, you know, and out of relationships because they get together in this mm-hmm. initial stage mm-hmm. and then they have fun. Well, and you ask them, well, what is so good about the relationship?
Right.
Oh, they're funny. Oh, he makes me laugh.
Right.
Oh, he's
okay,
cute.
So, what happens
so I'm like,
when
well, where's the substance?
Right.
Well, where's the substance?
Yeah,
in other words, when you get together for marriage, you better be on the same life path.
Yeah.
Together.
Okay.
So I just wanted to get that out.
Okay, now
there.
You are even taking it to a whole lot of dimension
yeah.
now here.
And TC, you could agree or disagree.
I mean, the thing about it, the relationship in my practice doesn't start mainly with the husband and wife. It starts with their parents because that's
right.
your foundation.
Right.
Sure. So if you come from divorced parents and you come from chaotic, you come from trauma, you're going to bring that in a relationship.
Yes.
And so what happens so many times with couples is that they start arguing, and unbeknownst to them, they're not arguing at the person, they're arguing at their parents now. Because as a child, you couldn't argue, you couldn't say anything. So now you take those bad attributes and bring in a relationship, and you wonder why now you're looking at someone so differently. Because you really understand that, listen, I got to understand what my parents gave me the foundation, either destroy or build upon.
Mm.
And I
yeah,
I completely agree with that because coming from parents who were divorced, my parents got divorced at the age of 6.
Wow.
So it was hard for me. I was an only child. I didn't really know how to deal with it. But
sure.
now being in a relationship and his parents are divorced as well, it's like, whoa. We can kind of relate to each other because we both know what it's like to have parents who are divorced. And we can kind of base our relationship off of that, but a lot of people can't. I completely agree with you. A lot of people cannot do that because they don't have that foundation.
Right.
They just blame it on everybody else.
Okay.
And also the trauma, it keeps being passed on from generation
to generation.
I was going
Correct.
To say, and that was one of the things that I kind of had identified in my notes, is that many of us are coming to relationship with a lot of brokenness. Exactly.
Yep.
And so I think, I don't want us to kind of be jumping here because we are touching on some really good stuff here.
Mm-hmm.
And so I want people to be able to kind of follow us very well.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm gonna come back to something that Mark said in terms of how do we even define marriage? How do we mm-hmm. define relationships? Because, you know, you were saying that, you know, in our generation, there's this goosebumpy, feeling good, it makes me happy thing. But when you look to the previous generation, to them it was more of a commitment. It was more of a partnership. It was, you know. So I think that even really now, the perspective which or how we even define what relationships is, what the whole point and the mission and the purpose of relationship is affecting how we stay in it and how we conduct it, don't you think?
See, the issue is that we live in a society, 2010, where everything is eye candy. But I tell couples all the time, too much eye candy gives you cavities. And the problem with a lot of couples is that, okay, he looks good, she looks great, you know, looking at the assets. But listen, we gotta go beyond that, understand what's going on in between the ears. Well, that's how it works. It's mind first, body goes from there. So our society has been built on how great we look as a couple and not how we look as a spirit, how we get along with each other and take it from there.
I think a lot of times nowadays, a lot of times people aren't really in relationship. So it is that goosebump and it is, well, I'm going to see how this works out.
Yeah.
When they're going to get married versus I'm going to be in union with this person forever.
Right.
You know, and so it's, you go from, my friends and I, we call it the representative. You know, so you meet the representative.
Yep.
And a lot of times people are getting married to someone and they're still dealing with the representative. They haven't really gotten into a relationship with each other to really know at the core, you're a good person or, you know, I love your soul.
Right.
But then doesn't that also have to do with the fact that many people haven't also really authentically connected with who they are?
Absolutely.
Okay, 100%. They don't even really know
it's
who
true.
They are.
That's a home run.
They don't
right
even
there.
Know. Yeah. They're either afraid to look inwards or they have never taken the time to define and identify who they are
the
and what their values are.
You can't look for someone to complete you. That's what people are, well, I need something to complete. No, you need to know who you are first. If you don't like McDonald's, why go someone that likes Burger King? I mean, it's not going to work. So understand who you are first. Once you understand who you are, then you can say, all right, can I deal with McDonald's every now and then because I like Burger King? I mean, and if I understand that, if I understand who I am, then when someone comes into my life, that I can find out, okay, I can deal with this for a lifetime or just a temporary thing. A lot of people make temporary decision when really it should be permanent one and vice versa as well.
Right.
Okay.
And
so
if you think about that whole Jerry Maguire, you complete me thing.
Yes.
The thing is you need to complete yourself first.
Correct.
Exactly.
Okay. And I think that's what we're kind of hitting on.
Correct.
So how do you define that? You know, and you know, a wise person won't get into the whole behind the scenes. Once told me, Mark, you have to really understand who you are if you're going to be successful in any facet of your life.
Right.
And the question was, and it's probably the hardest question anybody ever asked me, truly to this day. It's the simplest question, but it's also the hardest. And they asked me, what are you living for? You know, why are you living? What are you living for? If you can define that, that will help internalize exactly who you are as a person. And then you can then extemporaneously figure out what you're looking for in a mate to help you figure out what you are living for to then help not complete you, but enhance your life from that sex. So you're on the same mission.
You hit it on the mind.
Yes, exactly. And oh gosh, wow.
I think that if you don't know who you are before you get into a relationship, you don't know your value and you become what that person wants you to be. It was so easy for me to do that and not really understand my value and not even really understand what I could bring to this relationship. Not just what can I get from this relationship, but what do I bring to it? And knowing that makes you feel more confident and know that, you know, I'm an important part of this. It's not just, you know, I'm not going to become who this person wants me to be, but I know who I am and what
and
I bring.
I know what I bring and I know what the value that I bring to the table.
Right.
So it's about your self-worth, my self-worth, and what I'm bringing speaks to me that you understand that the relationship is a partnership.
Yes.
It is.
You know, it's not about one person really more or less getting from the other. I think oftentimes, you know, and I experienced this in the early part of my relationship, my marriage, and, you know, thankfully I was freed from that, whereby I kind of already set my husband up to fail because already my expectations were way too unrealistic, way too high, no human being could really meet up.
Yeah.
It was just a man.
Yeah.
And so I wanted him always to pay me compliments.
Yeah.
I wanted him always to notice when I got my hair done.
Yeah.
I wanted, you know, and he never seemed to do enough. It didn't have to do with him. It had to do with me.
And it's just not fair for him.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And so I think that's what happens to us as individuals when we come into that relationship broken, hurt, not knowing who we are. We now set the other person up and expect so much to be got to us.
But see, that's the problem, you know, is that a lot of times couples get married expecting that person to heal them. And to a certain extent, they can give you the tools, but you don't have to apply what they give you. Yes, they love you. Yes, they appreciate you. But you have to be the one to take the bomb or the tools and apply it to yourself. Because in my counseling practice, women who have very low self-esteem, and the guy says, "God, you look great." And the woman just cannot accept it because they came from trauma. They came from a father that never loved them. That's why it's so important as men that they really show their daughters how much love is. What is love? Because if you don't tell your daughter who love is, she'll find any definition to fulfill that definition of love.
Exactly. And so, you know, already we've touched on quite a number of things here. And like I said, you know, it's like we're, you know, we're going from here to there. But I really want to kind of bring it back now in terms of staying together. So far we've said, you know what, it's about how people conceptualize the whole kind of concept of marriage.
Right.
And how people really define it, and how people define themselves, and what kind of how they define their own mission and their own purpose will help them to determine whether they can live together successfully. Now, what about the cultural shift that has kind of taken place over the last couple of decades? And what I mean by that is that, you know, culturally, women are more empowered. Women are more educated. Economically, women
are doing better.
And so, you know, there's been a shift in terms of how women view themselves and how women want to be defined. And they don't have to stay around. The expectation is that you better treat me like a queen that I am.
That's right.
Otherwise, I'm out of the door.
That's correct.
Whereas two or three generations or decades or four or five decades ago, women weren't empowered economically.
Yes.
And so they would stay there and they would stick it out.
Not anymore.
Even though we do not have.
Then they get divorced and I want half.
Exactly. And they want half. And they know they're entitled to half. And there are laws to help them now.
Yeah.
So I think that also has come to play a large role in why women, you know, the divorce rate apparently seems high, because people and women are not just sticking around anymore and taking the abuse.
Yeah.
Because we don't have to anymore.
Yes, because they don't have to. They can survive on their own. Like you were saying, you were a single parent. Not that it was easy, but you did it for 14 years, and you could survive successfully and raise your son.
Successfully is questionable, but you know, I mean, being married now, I just, you know, I see now how much my husband adds into my son's life. I mean, ways I could have never even imagined.
Yeah.
And yeah, I could survive before. I survived, but it wasn't everything.
Okay,
You see, a relationship.
Which is why most singles want to be in a relationship. Be married, because they know the value that the partnership brings. Having one other, you know, two is better than one. And there's certain things you cannot do in terms of raising children as a woman by yourself.
Yeah, especially a son.
Kind of things you can bring and things you can model to your son, you know. So it is still valuable.
Yeah.
And people understand that. And so we're now kind of, you know.
Yeah, the key is that my favorite subject is communication and intimacy. Just like if H2O, you know, gives you water. Same thing. And what couples don't do is that they don't take what they do in the bedroom and apply it outside the bedroom. So if I want true love, I have to be into you. And you have to be into me. The problem is they don't take that mind frame outside the bedroom. Oh, only inside the bedroom, they got the into me. But outside of it, all right, instead of me thinking about me, okay, it's Wednesday. What are we going to do together? What's our date night? I mean, when you have those mind frames, then we can go further. But what happens is that we only have the mind frame of intimacy in the bedroom and not outside the bedroom. So the more I spend time with you, you spend time with me, we grow together. Versus, okay, it's been 5 months and we haven't seen each other for a while because we haven't really been in with each other. And that's what...
Exactly. And I think part of that also is societal.
Yes.
The stress. Yeah. You know, working hours, longer working hours, and you know, like we're saying, women also have it to work.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And your schedule doesn't end to end of kind of matching.
Right.
And all of that. And sometimes you could go weeks without seeing each other.
Sure.
And the only time you get
no
to
intimacy.
Meet each other. Exactly.
No intimacy.
So there's really no time for that communication and fellowship.
Zero.
That helps the relationship to grow.
Right.
And then suddenly you wake up one day, 6 months later, who's this stranger?
Exactly.
Who's this guy? Who are you? You know?
And there's a lot of the outside influences that take part, because when you are stressed out, you're looking for an easy feeling of making me feel good.
Right.
Yes.
So where a relationship is work, as you stated,
right.
and as TC stating, you know, you have this, you're into me,
yep.
you know, but then externally you're not.
Right.
Well, think of when all the stress is happening and all the stigma and all the influence we get out from all the other things that, you know, and I know we're kind of spiritual here and you turn our own ways, but think of all the stuff that's out there that's negative, that comes at us that's just easy.
Yeah.
You know, all the sites that are out there on the internet, all these other things, all this easy way to make us try to feel good,
right.
and all these easy, instant
exactly.
gratification sort of thing. Well, that makes me feel good, and that's all I want.
No.
So, you know, what TC is saying is so true. You have to understand that you have to be there for somebody else, and how can you make that person happy? I always think a good thought every day, because your day is so filled with stress, and if you really truly understand what's important at the home is, what can I do today to make the other person smile?
That's how it works.
Part of what I do for my clients here is the whole time management thing, the work-life balance thing, you know, because I think a lot of us have certain areas of our lives totally out of balance.
Sure.
Okay, you know, so it's either we're so career-driven that we do not have that time to spend and invest in our relationship, because by the time we get back, we're stressed out, or, you know, we're spending so much time on our personal life and not career, and that the lack of financial, you know, economic
security,
empowerment, security in the relationship, then affects the relationship, and then it brings stress and all of that. So
would you say that, and for both of you, would you both say, cause as a success coach, of which you're very dynamic at, and TC, I met you today, you seem very successful because you're very well-spoken, and you have all these books. Let me pose this question to a step of healing. Right, isn't the step of healing with anything, because we're so stressed and all these influences are happening, and we truly know the home is important, and we truly know that, but is it part to recognize? Is that like step one? Would you say like recognition, when you're trying to get someone to take an extra step somewhere in business, professionally, whatever it is, and follow their passion, is it recognizing that there's a flaw, recognizing that, hey, stop for a second, recognize the importance of something? Is that a step? Or
absolutely. I think beyond even the recognition, when the two are related, is the acknowledgement.
Sure.
Coming to acknowledge and own it.
Okay.
You know, because you could recognize it and be in denial.
Right.
And you could give all kinds of excuses
right.
for why it's like that.
Right.
Yeah.
And not
that
really,
sense.
You know, but then coming to that point that I don't only recognize, but I own this, I acknowledge it, and I know that this is me and where I am, and I'm, you know.
Yeah.
See, so there's a first step there.
Exactly.
And to add with it is also in a relationship, a husband-wife relationship, it's receiving what the person says.
Mm.
I tell my couples in my counseling, your spouse is your mirror.
Mm.
And if you cannot accept the mirror, there's going to be problems. So when my spouse gives me something, I must receive it. And when I don't receive it, then it's a form of rejection. And the rejection is very close related to a phase, because what you're doing, you are rejecting your wife, you're rejecting your husband. Mm-hmm. And so if you don't learn how to receive, then the person says, all right, he doesn't like me, she doesn't
Nobody.
Like me. And then here we go down the road, okay,
right.
now I don't know who I am, the self-worth goes down the road. So it's receiving what my spouse brings to the table. That's why dating is so important, because let me see the entire person. Let me see hair under. Let me see sometimes flatulation. Let me see everything about the person, because if I don't see the negative, then when I marry them, I say, where did this come from?
Exactly.
You know, I'll get the representative.
Yeah, I didn't know
exactly.
Members were like
exactly.
that.
Exactly.
You did that.
And I want to bring into the conversation Kelsey, because there is a generational shift. Mm. And I would also say immaturity. A lot of immaturity, because we're talking relationships and the whole dating, boyfriend, girlfriend thing at 9 these days.
Yes.
Yeah. Puppy love.
At 9 these days.
That's crazy.
At 15. And so that's why we see a lot of You know, in our culture, especially a lot of 15-year-olds yes. with babies.
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. We're talking, we're beginning the process so early mm-hmm. at a point where people don't have a clue yeah. what yeah. it's all about. And then we're not really equipping them right. or portraying the real, true meaning of what the relationship is in terms of, okay, the way it's trivialized mm-hmm. and glamorized
yes.
by the media,
right.
that, you know, you can just have a one-night stand nope. and, you know, you can just, you know, be in nope. and out of relationship.
Nope.
There are no commitment, no boundaries. The nope. whole thing is glamorizes, commercializes, you yeah, know, so and whatever else lies.
Yeah, so true. You got to go deeper because, yeah. you know, it's not just STDs of the flesh, it's STDs of the mind. Mm. If you don't understand that, when you get with somebody, you know, yeah, you may be covered and everything, but the mind, I mean, women especially, they get everything.
Yeah.
I mean, they get everything, and the guy says, all right, another one on my list, you know, yeah. and he goes on, and now she's giving everything to him. And so in our society, you said it correctly, that people just are so not understanding that with the title comes work. With the title, with husband, with wife, comes work. And so kids, 15 years old, that's my husband. No, that's not your husband. That's a guy that's 50 years old, still needs kid, his mom to drive him around. That's not your husband.
And it's all this definition of what love is. You know, it's now become for men, which is another reason why we're falling apart and can't stay together, is that it's very physical. Mm, okay, it's very physical because I can relate to that even though I'm married. Mm-hmm. When my husband wants to express love,
yes.
he's thinking of one thing maybe.
Yes.
He wants to make up, yes. after we have a fight, yeah. whatever thing,
yeah.
he's thinking of one
yeah.
thing. You know?
Yeah.
Hey, and I'm like, you know, no. what's the problem? No. No.
I know it has to be.
Hey, let's make up. No, no. let's talk.
Yeah. Yeah.
For me, it's more emotional.
Yes.
It's more emotional.
It's the way it should be. It's the way it should be.
You know? It's an understanding.
And so, when you are, we come to that understanding as couples and people of opposite sex that, hey, he's looking at it from a different perspective. It's that brain thing, you know?
Yep.
And you're thinking of a relationship. Mm-hmm. If you don't meet, you don't fulfill that emotional need that I have in the relationship, I'm out of the door. And if I don't meet your physical needs as a woman, he's also out of the door. And so sometimes we don't know that what the other person's needs are in terms of innate. I think it's innate. Mm-hmm. God-given thing mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. in terms of the way men and women are wired. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And like me and you mentioned before the broadcast, we were saying that I had seen a documentary and it was about how men, there's a difference between having sex mm-hmm. and making love.
Correct.
And men believe that having sex is the way to go, especially in college. I see it all the time as a college student. It's everywhere, everywhere. Even on TV. Yeah. I don't, obviously, none of you guys probably watch the show, but Jersey Shore, like I was saying to you before.
The situation.
The situation. Exactly.
All about it.
It is the worst show I've ever seen in my life, but yet I'm addicted to it. And it's because these men, the situation, they go out and meet girls at a club and they come back and they're like, oh, I just had sex with this one, that one, and the third. And then you're watching it and you're just like, but that's every day.
This is what I have to say to you viewers. We have to go back to our roots and the foundations and to the manual for what relationship is all about. Mm-hmm. The book. And some of these tips you'll find here, really and truly.
Yeah.
Are we in relationship at all? Because everything has been so glamorized and trivialized.
Yeah.
And I know we don't have so much time left. Can you believe it? And
how
I know.
You're lying.
Yeah, I know. And so, you know, we really want to start getting back to an understanding of why, you know, it was designed the way it was, that men and women and being in a relationship, you know, to stay together forever, for as long as possible, and all of that. So we need to really kind of get back to the basic and what sex is as a part of that process.
People understand that the word sex is not in Holy Writ, okay? But the word sex was just new. Genesis chapter 4, it says Adam knew Eve, okay?
Yes.
And the problem is that couples are not knowing one another. They want the sex then a relationship. No, it's relationship right. first. Right. Then comes intimacy when you become yes. married. But again, it's really knowing the person.
Yeah.
And like you said, your husband, yeah, you know, hey, if we had a fight, the best way we can make up is have sex. Wife is saying, get that thing away from me, you know, like, get away from me, you know. Because women are emotional. And I teach men that men, we are microwave. Women, they're ovens.
Yes, yes.
And it takes a while.
And then it takes a while to cool down.
There you go. There you go.
That's a good one. That's a good one.
However, on the flip side, when you do right by her, holla.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And now, before we... Because we only have a few minutes left on the show. I can't believe it.
Yeah,
you know, I know. What's happened?
Part three.
So maybe another sequel has to come because this is getting even more exciting by the minute. Maybe the next time we'll allow viewers, we'll allow you to be able to call in with your questions. But you can leave your comments on Facebook, online, on the internet. You know, join the conversation and let's keep it going, really, because... it is just, I know, life-changing for me. Even being here, you know, I'm learning one or two things.
Aren't you all, you know? Oh, yeah.
Aren't you getting a lot of good tips and strategies for your great relationship? Well, now I want us to kind of move forward from there. I think we've been able to identify so many reasons now that I'm not sure that I can keep tab of how many reasons why we probably can't stay together, from the generational shift to how women are more economically mm-hmm. empowered. Mm-hmm. We've touched on how, you know, society and the media is helping to trivialize and some parts glamorize a lack of commitment and one night stands.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, we've touched on how we define marriage, our perspective of marriage, our love languages as men and women being different. So we've kind of touched on quite a number of things. But I want us to move forward and now begin to talk to single men and women that are watching the broadcast in terms of how to really attract the right mate. Yeah. Because I know that some of you out there, you know, you're part of the... You're part of the statistics.
Lord.
Okay, many are part of the statistics. They're single as a result of being divorced. And we don't want to make the same mistakes the same time. A second time around, over and over again. And I know many single people want to be in a relationship. Mm-hmm. There's statistics that is 80 to 90% want to actually be in marriage relationship, not just being in a committed, they want to be married again.
Right.
Okay, so it's that high. So how do we help them? Okay. How do they attract the right mate, you know, I mean, the right person into their lives? And from you, from Marisol, from you having made the mistake before your divorce, mm-hmm. Why do you think that happened? Why do you think your first relationship ended?
Well, I was just going to add that I think one of the issues is technology and the whole text messaging and the cell phones, and that has come in between people having actual relationships and communication mm-hmm. relationships and being able to have healthy relationships where you can communicate with one another. I just recently got text messages, but one of the big issues I did not want text messages because men just love to text message.
Yeah.
They don't answer the phone and pick up and have a one-on-one conversation
and that's just the price we're paying, even in business circles. And that's why I'm still old school. I'm a really recent convert to all Facebook and social media because I'm old school, getting my face one-on-one in person, kind of networking and relationship building. That's what it's all about,
right?
You know, and it gets very impersonal.
It becomes so impersonal. But
exactly.
I have a perfect example. I met this one individual a while back ago, and we exchanged great conversation. At the end of the night, instead of a phone call, it was here's my Facebook. That was the first time. It's so impersonal.
Yeah.
And that's what single people are dealing with right now.
Okay, so
you gotta check him off your list.
Now trying to help single people find the right mate.
Like
I was gonna say, so you would say that your first marriage was impersonal. That was one of the major things that contributed to it ending?
No, I just think that it was just two people, great people. We came together and it just didn't work. And mutually we decided that, you know.
Why do you think it didn't work?
It didn't work because I think we were too young.
So the immaturity.
It was the immaturity, not the lack of experience.
Exactly.
And trying to come together. Yeah. And we learned both. But, you know, we're great friends now.
I know, I'm
and,
sure.
And But it's just a lack of communication and the maturity.
Okay, so tell me two things, which we've touched on why this whole the part of why we can't stay together is the maturity and, you know, people coming into relationship, talking relationship at such early age, at the teenage years, where they have no clue. The other thing we didn't touch about that we talked to before the broadcast began was, you know, it seems like sex and relationship and marriage is something that people put in the closet.
Yeah.
Somehow they just can't seem to be able to talk openly
about it.
And we empower and on all spheres of life. But that and find money is one thing we're not doing for our kids.
No, right.
You know, that we never talk about. So they grow up and they find, what do I do with it? Now I've come to that age. I don't have the
Again, going back tools. To the text. You know, Adam and Eve were naked and they were not ashamed. That's the text. And what happens with couples is that they discover one another and they are ashamed of what they see. And it's not just the physical, it's the emotional. So for singles, I tell them, number one, make sure your picker is not broke. Because a lot of times, you're picking the wrong people. You're looking for the glamour, you're looking for the sweet tooth. Secondly, you got to CSI the person. Don't just look at the external. CSI. Get Social Security. Get FICO score. Last addresses. Talk to last boyfriend, girlfriend. Do all with all that stuff in the background. And you do that. These are like, now I can make a conscious decision. Right. Why most people break up is that they don't see the obvious. And I tell couples, don't just see the signs, read the signs.
And what I wanted to add to that is discover yourself first. Okay, get to know.
Get a good coach like you. Yeah,
I agree. Yes.
Know
yourself, know your vision, know your values, know your needs, and really kind of define that and identify that. You know, because I find that people who do not know who they are, they keep attracting the same person over and over. They don't know their self-worth and their value. Right. And so that's for you for singles.
And once you know that, you know, because I'm single, this is what I'm learning about myself, is once you actually know that, when you start dating, you know, the date shouldn't be, really, that's your favorite movie too? Oh my gosh, isn't that the funniest line? Has nothing to do with your value. Find out what their value is.
Exactly.
It's okay to ask the question.
Absolutely.
What do you believe in?
Exactly. And what your life's missions is and your
vision. So it's okay to ask those questions early on in the dating process.
Absolutely.
Because then you can date a lot more and start weeding out
the
wrong people.
I even take it further that, you know, once you define who you are, your vision, you automatically
withdraw.
Right.
Wow. Withdraw.
Right. That's correct.
And that will help you already eliminate.
Already. Right.
Also, certain people just, you won't even waste your time. You just already, you don't qualify. And so, because we have just 5 more minutes, we have to die.
That's crazy.
We have to die.
It's your fault.
It's your fault.
We now have to talk to the married, okay? So maybe you're married already, but how do you stay married? Mm. You know, because each marriage relationship, if we're being sincere, hits those rocks and obstacles and roadblocks and mountains, you know. And I was saying, and that's why I like one of your books about even people of faith, because sometimes you want to spiritualize it and say, oh, you know, just have God.
There's no amazing grace in the married bedroom. There's no amazing grace. You might listen to amazing grace.
Go to church. And I'm not trying to disparage the importance of praying together and believing together and having the same values.
All very important.
But that is not all of it.
No.
You know, there are other things that you need to also do to get the whole perfect picture of what it means to have a great relationship, which is why the divorce rate is also as high in faith circles than in non-faith circles.
So what
would you say in 1 minute to married couples as one of the main chief key ingredients, you know, in terms of needing to add, I'm talking now, in talking cooking language, to spice up Rachel Ray, that whole remarriage thing, so that they don't also become one of the statistics.
I mean, well, Mark knows this quite well. You have to invest. Mm-hmm. And couples don't invest in each other. So I teach my men, for example, always touch your wife. Non-sexually, always touch her. Touch your hair. One of my practices is telling the men, buy a comb, and the comb is only for your wife, and you only comb your wife's hair when she wants it combed. Now you are investing. You may not like it, but there's benefits down the road. Holla. So when you invest in one another, and also it's not just the man investing in the woman, it's the woman also investing in the man. Yeah. So sometimes surprise him. When he comes home, hardworking man doing right, just wear nothing but a raincoat. He'll appreciate that.
Exactly. And I really want to touch on this investment, which is where culturally also our value seems to be changing.
Yes.
And our values has become more materialistic, mm-hmm. it's more mm-hmm. money-driven, mm-hmm. it's the almighty dollar. Mm-hmm. But we all know that that is not what life
money
is all about.
Money can't buy love.
No.
Look at, and you know what I say? What I say is that even if you hone your skills professionally and you're on top of the game, look at Tiger Woods. And I'm not trying to, he's a classic example for us today, okay? That if you don't also hone your skills personally, sure. in your private,
you're
personal life,
okay.
at the end of the day, you know what's going to happen? One is going to topple the other.
He hasn't won since then.
Exactly. It just tells
in
you.
In any facet of his life.
That's right.
So it just goes to, and we're not really mocking him here, just a classic example of the need for us to really be balanced
right.
and to have all spheres of our lives in harmony and invest. Because, but we don't invest in things we don't value.
That's right.
So we still need to start investing and valuing our personal lives
right.
and investing in it.
Right.
And, you know, that is all we have for today. I cannot believe that one
Great
hour.
Job.
Thank
Great
you
job.
So much.
One hour just went like that.
Great job.
You know, but I am sure, I am absolutely sure that you have just been so totally inspired and informed. I have, you know, and I'm sure I'm going to get my husband, hey, honey, this one you much watch, you know, and, you know, make sure you get your spouse, your whoever, your significant other to watch this show, because I'm sure that you can relate, you can start a conversation one-on-one as a result. Let's continue the conversation on Facebook. I want to remind you of the Total Women's Conference. That's coming up on Saturday, June 5th. Now, we're going to be really reaching a whole new kind of demographic. It's the girls and young women. And we need to catch them young. We need to start empowering them for success very young. We don't need to wait till they're older before we do it. So make it a date. Save the date. November 6, 2010 at St. Joseph's College. Go to my website, www.royalproclamations.com. Pastor Brantley has some books and programs and seminars that are upcoming as well,
yes.
and a lot of resources.
Rest.org.
Just go to rest.org, rest.org. A lot more is going to be coming up in the next couple of months on Inspired Success. That's relating to finishing 2010 strong as we're wrapping up the year. So next month's show is about finishing 2010 strong. And then in December, we're going to be really looking at what 2010 taught us. What has this year taught you? And I really invite you to be part of the conversation. Again, this is Princess Bola Adelani, the Total Success Coach, reminding you to keep smiling. No, hey, put a smile on your face. Life's too short. Keep believing. Keep networking. Keep learning. Keep on keeping on. And from my studio audience,
thank you very much.
Goodbye. Thank you. Tune in next month. I'll see you soon. God bless.